Good morning. Would you please stand and sing with us our call to worship? Let's go to the house of the Lord. 1, 2, 3. You have brought new life and we have a new beginning. And so, Father, in this hour we pray that all of our prayers, all of our songs, all that we say, all of our interactions will be about celebration. Celebration of new life and a new beginning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Take a moment to greet those around you as we pass the peace of Christ.
Yeah. Seated. I hope everybody got a bulletin when you came in, and I hope you've taken a moment to look through it very carefully. I want to, before we do anything, thank each and every one of you for being in the house of the Lord to worship today, and especially want to extend a welcome to all those who are visitors among us. The people of this church are glad that you're here, and we're here to serve you. If you need anything, you can ask anybody, and we would love to help you out. And we do want everybody to give us a record of your attendance. And the way you do that here is there's a little flap in the bulletin. And if you'll give us your name and check any items on that flap that apply to you and tear that off and put it in the bulletin, then we'll be able to serve you better. Also, that flap allows you to be able to let us know that you're coming to Wednesday night supper. And we've got a great Wednesday night supper coming up this Wednesday. We're having bacon-wrapped pork tenderloin, butter beans, hash brown, casserole. We do need to know ahead of time if you're coming. I understand that this week is the Fuque Anderson team. That's going to be great. So you want to give us a note that you're going to be here, and we'll have a great night on Wednesday. We have also added during our Wednesday night supper time a time of devotion and song and prayer, and that happens at 5:30. But you can come anytime from 5 until 6 to eat and join your church family for supper on Wednesday nights. We also have had a wonderful growth in our children and youth programs on Wednesday night. If you've got a teenager, bring your teenager on Wednesday nights. And I was so glad to see that our children's program was featured in the Jackson County Times this past week for one of our Wednesday night activities. Once a month, we have a mission night, and our children went to celebrate the firemen in our community. And I want to thank Jennifer Nolan and Elizabeth Flowers for their leadership in organizing that night of mission for Wednesday night, and Becky Grimsley for all she's doing to get our children's program just humming and moving forward in great ways. Also, our teenagers have an opportunity this weekend. On Saturday, we're going to have a beach trip, and everybody's welcome. We would like to know ahead of time how many we'll have, so all the teenagers make plans to come this coming Saturday for a trip to the beach on Saturday. You can contact me for more information. Something that's not in your bulletin that you need to know about: our older adult ministry has a new name. It's called Forever Young, and they are meeting tomorrow. Forever Young. Well, why are you laughing? That's a great name. That's good. And so they're meeting tomorrow, and we have special guests Peggy Cox and Sue Bradley who are going to be singing. You won't want to miss it. So bring a friend tomorrow to Forever Young. We'll have a great time of fellowship together. As we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, before I list off prayer concerns, I want to share a testimony. We've been praying for some time for Mark Vickery, who's been battling cancer, and we got this report from his wife Karen this week. She wrote, "The biopsy report shows no cancer cells in Mark's bone marrow. We're somewhat in disbelief, but I'm realizing God's power of healing and the power of prayer offered by so many." That's you. Is that Mark? He's here today. You have been missed around here. Wow, it's great. I didn't know you were going to be here, and it means so much to me to look up and see your face. We love you. Well, I'm going to continue reading this testimony, okay? He is to stop taking his daily chemo pill and will not have to go for his last chemo treatment. He'll have to report to UAB for monitoring. Y'all have helped get us through this crisis of no hope and have set us on the right road. Mark is going to have to work hard to get all the poison out of his system and his strength back. We love you and thank you for all your prayers and concern. We love you. And if you don't believe that God hears and answers prayer, take a look at Mark Vickery. We love you. Be praying also for Merle Houston, who's had surgery this week and is recovering. Jean Lawrence, who has been hospitalized and is recovering. With these and other concerns, let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Holy God, we thank you for your goodness to us. You've gathered all humanity into yourself and you've redeemed us through a tremendous price. Your Son Jesus has made a new humanity and has made our lives completely new. You've offered us new life, a new beginning, a new way of living. Help us, Holy Father, to live fully in the light of the grace that has been offered to us. We thank you on this World Communion Sunday that we who were not a people have been made a people. You have made us a kingdom of priests. You have given us a new name. You have made us a new family. You've made us a holy nation. A people of God in every nation, called out among every tribe and tongue. On this day, we celebrate our communion, our community, our connection with all Christians in all times and places. We humbly pray that you would unite us with our brothers and sisters for the sake of the gospel mission. And we pray today for Christians around the world, especially those who maintain their testimony to your Son in lands in which they're persecuted for their confession. And help us all to work with equal diligence and faithfulness. Teach us to serve with joy and resolve and generosity. May all Christians throughout the world make the Great Commission our purpose for living until the world has been won to your Son. And we pray for our Christian brothers and sisters in our own community. We're so often tempted to think of ourselves as many churches, while our unity in your Son teaches us that there's but one church. And so, God, we ask that you would bless the churches and believers in our community of all denominations, Baptists and Catholics and Lutherans and Assemblies of God, Nazarenes and Episcopalians and Presbyterians and non-denominational, white churches and black churches and Hispanic churches. All are your children and all are our family. And so, God, may the false divisions that separate us dissolve in the blood of Jesus. Teach us how to work together until every person in Marianna has been utterly transformed by the love of Jesus Christ. We have little to offer you, but all that we have been given has come from you. And so, Father, we open our hands, we open our hearts, and we trust you as best as we know how. Use our little faith, and as we offer what we have to give together, we ask that you would do great miracles for us and through us. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord of the church, the Lord of all the church, the Lord of all of us, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We've got a special gift today. Katie is going to be playing a special with her mama. Oh, so good. Thank you. We invite all our children now to come forward for the children's meeting.
Come on down this morning to see me. I'm wide-eyed and bushy-tailed. I've had no sleep. I've had all three grandchildren with me since Friday. But it's been fun. Wouldn't have it any other way. I just found out I'm not as young as I used to be. Y'all come on in and sit down. That was beautiful.
That was great. So good.
Beautiful. Can y'all squinch up like sardines? Here you go, Katie. There you go. Oh, yeah, right there. That'll be fine. Come on. I need you down here with me. Come on. Hey, how you this morning? Sit. Sit right. Can he sit by Blake? There you go. Your name is what? Owen. Well, Owen, I'm so glad to have you. I like to see these new faces. All right. Do you know what? We live around in Jackson County. One of our biggest industries around here is farming. We got lots of farmers, and they grow those good old peanuts that I like to boil. We do. We have lots of farmers, and you know what? It reminded me of a story in the Bible about Jesus. He was telling about it, that this man planted some seeds, and some of them got blown away by the wind. Some of them got scorched up by the sunshine. Some of them just got eaten up by the birds. And then there were some of them that got planted and grew into a great crop. And that Bible story reminded me the other day I was sitting in my sunroom and I heard this sound go click, 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 clop, click, click, clop. And I thought, boy, those are big old raindrops. Looked up at the sunroof and it wasn't raindrops. And then I thought that was a spider up there. That's why I thought, I don't want that spider to fall on me. Okay, I'm sorry, that just blew my mind. Okay, back to my story now. It does, doesn't it, Trip? So I walked outside to see what it was. And do you know what it was? It was acorns hitting my sunroof up there and falling on the patio. Take one of these acorns, okay? And they fell on my patio. And I looked at that acorn and I thought, gee, that's a small little acorn that, no, don't eat them. No. And they grow into a mighty oak tree. But you know what? Some of them, yes you can. And some of them, oh, and you can have one too, but don't eat it. Okay. And some of them, they get stomped on. They get stomped on. They get eaten by the squirrels and the deer in my backyard. And some of them fall on good ground. And they grow into the mighty oak tree from this tiny little seed right here. And you know what? That's the same way with our lives. You know, if we let Jesus be the one to guide us and we fill our lives with His Spirit and His Word, then our lives will grow to be a mighty service to Jesus. And that's what we're here. That's why you come on Sunday in Sunday school. That's why you come on Wednesday night. That's why you listen to Brother Nathan right there. He helps us learn the things that we need to know so that we can grow mighty and strong in Jesus. And we don't want to be weak and blow away like that. So I want you to learn all you can about living for Jesus. Okay? Let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, I just thank you for every one of these children here today. What a blessing. I thank you for this church, dear Lord, that has taken a believing that the children are important in our church. And I thank you that we're going to grow into mighty warriors for Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Amen.
If the ushers will come forward, we'll receive our morning tithe and offering. They are a sign of our love, and they are a gift from our heart. And so, Father, we pray that you would use them. And like these acorns, may they be the seed that brings faith into the world. And may you make a great difference for the gospel of Jesus Christ through them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And we invite our children to come and join us.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from the gospel according to Luke chapter 17. I invite you, if you haven't done so already, to turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 17. We'll read today from the 5th verse through the 10th verse. Listen for God's word as we share it together today. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had the faith of a mustard seed, you could say to the mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you not rather say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron, serve me while I eat and drink. Later you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, please. We're starting a new series for the month of October, and this series is going to be about new life. We believe that when we have encountered Jesus Christ, that He makes all things new. Jesus said, "Behold, I make all things new. If anyone be in Christ, there is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and all things have become new." Jesus describes for us what that new life looks like. We can't, by our own effort, make ourselves into new people. We are not just broken people who need to be reformed. We are dead people who need to be resurrected, right? And only God can do that for us. And yet, there's a partnership between what God initiates in us and our participation in the grace that has freely been offered to us. In the book of Philippians, Paul says, "It is God who is at work in you to will and to work according to His good pleasure." It is God who is the one who brings salvation to us and is always saving us. But then he says, in the same passage, in the verse previous, he says, "So work out your salvation in fear and trembling." And so for the next few weeks, I want to share some signs of new life, what it looks like when God is making things new, how we can test the work that He's doing in us and recognize it and celebrate it and jump in with what God has already begun in us. And so today we begin with the first sign of new life, and that is faith. Faith. What is faith? It's a word we throw around a lot. What does it mean to have faith? Faith is relational. It's the description of our relationship to God. And in particular, faith is a description of a relationship with God where we trust God. It is a dynamic trusting of God. Faith is a sure conviction that God loves us, that He is for us, that He is working on our behalf. It is living our lives knowing that God is faithful, that we believe in God's power, and that we trust in God's love. That's what faith is. And furthermore, faith is a trust that translates into action. It's not just an opinion that we hold in our head. It's a dynamic trusting that causes us to live differently. We trust God, and so we act on the basis of that trust. Abraham was sitting around not knowing God, not knowing anything about God. He was just a pagan in the middle of a pagan land, and God came to him and said, Abraham! And Abraham, he was just a pagan. He didn't know God. So he said, who's that? It's God. Which one? Just God. And Abraham heard God say, get up and let's go for a walk. And he said, where are we going? And God said, don't worry about it. That's a paraphrase. It's a loose paraphrase. I'll show you when we get there. And he followed God the rest of his life. And the Bible says Abraham believed God. It was counted to him as righteousness. So faith is not believing in our head that if somebody were to jump out of an airplane, that a parachute would keep them from becoming a greasy spot on the ground. Faith is strapping on the parachute and jumping and pulling the cord. So faith is about obedience. It's obedience not because we are subservient to God, but because we trust in His love and we believe that what He tells us is the best thing for us. So faith translates into faithfulness. People who trust God get up day after day and follow Him faithfully. And when they get tired, they keep on trucking with God. We have a phrase that describes this nature of faith. We talk about keeping the faith. Billy Joel sang about it. Keeping the faith. It's a trust that causes us to keep on trucking. So the disciples are concerned about their faith. And they come to Jesus and they say, Jesus, increase our faith. How many of y'all have ever prayed that prayer? Jesus, increase my faith. Nobody? Whew, I've prayed that many times. We trust God, but we wonder, do I have enough faith? Do I trust God enough? I've got doubts. I say that I believe, and yet, if faith translates into obedience, I disobey many times. Many times. We're not always faithful, and so we say to God, help, help, increase our faith. Does that sound familiar? It's the disciples' cry of the heart, and it's our cry of the heart. We're people whose faith, our dynamic trusting of Christ, it waxes and wanes. Mine does. Some days I wake up and all I feel is the Spirit and let's go. And some days I wake up and I just barely drag out of bed and I feel my faith is no bigger than the height of a slug. And sometimes we doubt our faith for good reasons. Things don't work out. We fail. Sometimes we doubt our faith for no good reason. We just wake up not feeling it. So the disciples come to Jesus and say, increase our faith. Increase our faith. And Jesus' answer is, I'm not into big faith. He says, if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you can speak to the mulberry tree and it will get up and throw itself into the sea. So we like big stuff. We want to be heroes of faith. But God is not into our heroics. God is into blessing little things. And God says, through Christ, to you and I, whose faith is small, your small faith is all I need to change the world. God doesn't like spiritual heroes, spiritual big shots. God is looking for people who have humble faith, humble people, ordinary people through whom he can do extraordinary things and he is glorified. He says, do you have faith like a mustard seed, a tiny cheap thing, a common thing, an almost unnoticeable thing, a highly ordinary faith, a faith that is like a weed, overlooked. He says, I take that kind of faith. In another passage, he says, that faith of a mustard seed, that unnoticeable seed, it grows into a great big bush. You can't get rid of it. Slowly, imperceptibly, it takes over that little thing because God makes it grow. We don't have a lot of mustard plants around here, but we do have something that is a good parallel in our culture. You know what that is? Kudzu. Man, kudzu is like a common, ordinary thing. But don't plant no kudzu. It's going to take over. And it just creeps. It just goes deep. It spreads out. And once you got a little bit of kudzu, you got a problem. Y'all, we here at the church have a kudzu problem. Are y'all aware of that? We got kudzu behind our office building, back by the playground. And sometimes the trustees talk about the kudzu and we discuss whose problem it is. Or what might be done about that problem. But what we agree about is when you got kudzu, you got a problem. You can't make it go away once it's taken root. If you can live in the faith that you have already been given, God can grow it into something that takes over, that cannot be contained. God took flesh as a human being, a man with a seemingly insignificant life, a humble man who offered a poor life of service, a life beautiful before God, a life that was sown in death on the cross, that sprouted a new life. And here today on World Communion Sunday, we recognize that ordinary life that was beautiful before God was the most extraordinary life of any human being who ever lived. And it launched a movement of humble, ordinary people who used the little faith they had and spread out all over the earth. Like kudzu, the kingdom of God, the people of God have taken over. Billions of Christians around this world are a witness to the power of little faith put into action. In another place, Jesus says, after he tells the story of the mustard seed, that if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you can speak to the mountain and it will move. At one point, I was blessed to take a trip to Israel and I got to see a mountain that had been moved. Herod, who's in the Bible, in the New Testament, wanted to build a building and there was a mountain in the way of his view. And so he got a bunch of slaves with a bunch of shovels and a bunch of buckets, and they moved that mountain. How do you move a mountain? One bucket at a time. It's not heroic, but it's born of a bedrock trust that one humble act of obedience in the name of Jesus Christ can change the world, can change a life, can make all things new. There's a man who lived in India. His name was Dashrath Manji. He lived in a little village that was isolated from any resources. There was a mountain between his village and the next village where there was medical resources, places to find food and that sort of thing. And one day he was doing business on the other side of the mountain, and his wife tried to bring him lunch and climb the mountain. And in climbing the mountain, she fell. She was injured. And they were unable to get her to a hospital. And soon afterwards, she died. So this man said, you know, there needs to be a way to get through that mountain so people don't have to go around it and they don't have to get hurt climbing it. Nobody would help him. So he took a chisel and he took a hammer and he decided to break the mountain. For 22 years, when he was not working, he began to chip away at that mountain. 22 years, every day, with a hammer and a chisel, until he created a road that was 365 feet long and allowed the people of that village to cut their commute to the nearest town from 55 kilometers to 15 kilometers. People of the village thought he was crazy, but he saved many of their lives by every day, being faithful, using the faith he had until he broke the mountain. We don't need the Lord to increase our faith. We need eyes to see the gift we've been given, to use what we have, and allow God to turn it into a miracle. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite those who would come and help us to serve communion to come forward. The heart of Christ is open to all. The table of the Lord is open to all. Christ our Lord invites to his table all those who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, who seek to live in peace with God and with each other. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves Christ's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. In love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, your love remained steadfast. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast, that, renewed by your word and sacraments, and fervent in prayer and works of justice and mercy, we may come to the fullness of grace that you have prepared for those who love you. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to redeem the world. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and being born in our likeness, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. He took upon himself our sin and death and offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the whole world. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. We'll be serving communion by intinction. After we serve the choir, we'll come down to the front, and the ushers will direct you to come to the center aisle. You'll be given a piece of bread, and we ask you to hold on to that bread for a moment, and somebody will come behind with a cup. If you'll dip the bread in the cup and then partake. Any gifts that are left in the offering plate at the front there will go to Chipola Family Ministries to serve those who are in need. The table of the Lord is prepared, and all are welcome. If Christ is broken for you, is your glory.
Christ the first parents. Be not conformed to the pattern of this world. For as my brothers and sisters, and go in peace, and may the God of peace and love go with you. Amen. Sisters, and go in peace, and may the God of peace and love go with you. Amen. Have faith as mustard seed. The Lord is faithful and he will strengthen and protect you from the evil one. Rise, my brothers and sisters, and go in peace, and may the God of peace and love go with you. Now may the Lord peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. Arise, my brothers and sisters, and go in peace. By God's name. be with you and give you peace and the spirit of faith. We pray in Christ's name. Now, my brothers and sisters, you may rise and go in peace. Amen. keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over you coming and going. Arise, my brothers and sisters, and go in peace. And may the God of peace and faith be with you. Amen.
Stand for our closing hymn, my breath.
Thank you.
grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Father God, the presence and the comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve our Lord.